Hi everyone, and welcome back to Fast Charge. This week I'm joined by two of our stalwarts. We have Chris and Toddy here on the chat with me.
Oh, we both saluted.
Yeah.
That wasn't
simultaneous.
We run a tight ship here at Tech Advisor, I'll have you know.
Perfectly synchronized as ever. Okay, this week we are going to take a look at Q1 phone sale numbers, which normally would be a bit dry, but actually they're kind of interesting this time around. Then Toddy is going to run us through the Realme X3 SuperZoom, which he's been playing around with for last week and just had its official launch. And then finally, we are going to talk all things Huawei as the company's troubles continue. This time it looks like Kirin processors might be done for. Q1 phone sales. Normally we don't like talk phone sale figures. They can be a bit dry. But I think the Q1 worldwide figures that just got released are actually pretty interesting because they paint a picture that's unexpected to me at least, which is that the iPhone 11 is at the top, which isn't that odd, but it's way, 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 way at the top. I think the figures are, yeah, for Q1, so that's January, February, and March of this year. The iPhone 11 shipped 19.5 million units over that three-month period. To put that in context, the second biggest phone was Samsung's mid-range Galaxy A51. That shipped 6.8 million units. That's basically a third of the iPhone 11. And then to put it in context in the other direction, if you look at Q1 2019, so a year ago, Apple also sat at the top of that chart with the iPhone XR. But that was 13.6 million units, so a lot less than the 19.5 that the iPhone 11 has run, which is interesting. I knew the iPhone 11 was doing very well, but I didn't expect it to be sitting this sort of clear above both previous iPhones and its competition.
When I heard the story just about the iPhone specifically, I was like immediately reminded of the XR, but I didn't realize just how much more successful the 11's been, and I'm not entirely sure why. I guess most of those sales were made before lockdowns in the various countries took effect and the mm-hmm. market kind of plummeted to the degree that it has. So I guess they just got in under the wire there because of when they released the phone.
Yeah, there's definitely a timing element here. This obviously is the first 3 months, so that covers at least looking at the West. January and February were pretty much business as usual. So two of those 3 months were what you'd expect. Obviously a little bit different when you look at Asia, the timing of sort of when lockdowns went in and how they played out was very different. I mean, it's also, you know, telling that Apple's done well sort of throughout that list. I think there are four iPhones in the top 10 shipped phones for Q1. The XR still shipped another just about 5 million. And then the 11 Pro Max and the 11 Pro. So it's a good quarter for Apple. Otherwise, it is literally just Samsung and Xiaomi are the only other two brands that crack the top 10. Last year, Oppo snuck in there as well with the A5, but there's no sign of anyone outside of those three. It may not be a huge surprise to see there's no Huawei. Like I said, we'll be talking about Huawei later, but they couldn't make the top 10 this time. I mean, I am surprised the iPhone 11 has done this well. I wonder how much of it, say compared to the XR last year, I wonder how much it benefits from a really smart branding play, which is to give the core flagship brand to a phone that's actually still, relatively speaking, affordable. You know, the iPhone 11 is actually a fairly similar phone to the XR, and it's fairly similar priced in terms of how they were at the times they launched. And where they sat in the specs lineup. But the XR was positioned as not budget, but the kind of the cheaper equivalent of the XS, whereas the 11 is the flagship, and then there's the flagship
yeah
up above with the Pro and the Pro Max.
Are almost like the S20 Ultra, aren't they? They both serve that same kind of like super high-end, super OTT purpose. Yeah.
So it means you can feel like you're getting the latest, the greatest iPhone if you buy an iPhone 11, but actually still only spend $700 and not worry about cracking a grand, which from a sort of marketing position seems pretty savvy to me, and it looks like that's paid off.
Apple's an interesting organization, especially right now. I think that they have done this for a while, but they I think, especially with the mobile market, and I would assume that in the next quarter, the iPhone SE 2020 might make an appearance in that list as well. You know, whenever Apple releases an affordable iPhone, it just sells. Like, there's no doubt in anyone's mind. I don't think they've ever released, like, even the 5C, I don't know the figures on that, but I have a feeling that went down pretty well as well back when they introduced that. But at the other end of the spectrum, I think they still need to release these, you know, easily breaking £1,000, $1,000 mark devices, and, you know, like the Mac Pro wheels that are like $700, whatever it was, $400. I think they do that because they also, that's just perception. So consumers are going to buy the cheap Apple stuff, but they need to make the expensive Apple stuff so that people still think of Apple as this ridiculously ultra premium brand. I think it's all about perception. It's almost like a bravado, if you will. And it's interesting how they're structuring that in things like their phones, where the market, where the difference between the highest and the lowest products in that range aren't as big. But yeah, the 11, I think, it's a great phone. Like, I think no one in the office has ever said anything bad about it in terms of it being like a decent choice or recommendation. It's a solid phone. So I'm not surprised it is where it is.
Yeah, I'm not surprised either. It's just like, it's that very unoffensive, sort of safe option.
People pleaser.
It's the sweet spot, isn't it? I think that's what we said in both of our reviews on TechAdvisor and Macworld. It was like, you know, this is the sweet spot iPhone that's going to be for most people. Obviously, there are, you know, a percentage of people that still want the Pro or the Pro Max because they're that type of user, but they're still going to, you know, they're always going to be in the minority spending that much and really getting the benefit from those extra features.
Yeah. And you do see the same sort of story on the Samsung side. I mean, obviously, the way they brand it is different. But like I said, the top Samsung one for the quarter was the A51, not one of their flagship ones. And actually, the A51 is priced, I think that runs a little cheaper than an iPhone 11, but not that much cheaper than an iPhone 11, despite not being branded S series or anything. It's not a great look for Samsung's flagship range. With the obvious caveat that they only came out in February, so they only had half of this quarter to play with. But the only S20 in the top 10 is the S20 Plus.
I'm surprised it's the Plus, not the standard as well.
Yeah, well, so last year, both the S10 and the S10 Plus made it into the top 10 with 5 million each, basically. And the S10, the S10 was 5.2 million for the quarter. The S10 Plus was 5.1 million. So basically the same tiny edge to the regular 10. This time around, the Plus model is the only one that's cracked it. S20 sales have been down on S10 sales across the board. There probably is also an effect of splitting the sales three ways. This is just looking at top 10 handsets. So, you know, if all the Ultra, people who bought the Ultra might have bought the Plus otherwise, that would shift sort of around and makes it harder for them to crack the top 10 with individual handsets. But still, 3.5 million S20 pluses versus 5 million S10 pluses in the same period last year is not great for Samsung. They do make it up with A series, and they have three A series phones in the top 10. And because they have so many other mid-range and budget devices, I think their overall smartphone sales are still higher than Apple. They just don't concentrate quite as much in those top few because they have a bigger range of handsets.
One thing I have noticed that I'm surprised that the A51 is where it is in the number two spot is, you know, I've seen plenty of marketing for Apple's, any of the 11 series, iPhone 11s, but I have not seen a single ad, I think, for the A51. I only really know about it because, you know, we covered it at CES this year when they first brought it out on show, I think. That's an odd one. I'm assuming that is from markets like India, where Samsung's affordable offerings are probably going to sell better than the flagship stuff.
Yeah, I think that's sort of where they pick up a lot of that. Especially with the A series, they have so many A series devices that they tend to be a bit inconsistent about which ones ship in which market. So I'm not even sure if the A51 is available in all of the core markets you might normally expect it to ship in.
True.
You do have to wonder if they'll start looking at trying to replicate that Apple model where they bring the S30, I guess, down to position it a bit more like they've currently got. I guess they're trying to do it already with the S10 Lite and the Note 10 Lite, is trying to get that S branding to an A price point. But I wonder if slapping Lite on the end really gets the same effect versus just bringing the core S10, S20, S30 down to a more affordable point and then ramping it up with the Ultras above it.
That's a great example of where Samsung doesn't do as good a job as Apple, is just keeping things simple and saying, right, here's, You know, Apple's always done this where it's like, okay, here are your five different iPhones to choose from. It's quite clear how, you know, they go up in price and specs and stuff. Mm-hmm. Whereas Samsung, you know, there's a million and one different A phones, and yes, they do well without any marketing. But I suppose that's because in the markets that they do well in, it's because retailers are quite happy to pick them up and they'll sell from people walking in stores and seeing them and going, oh, that's a Samsung phone. I can't really afford an S20 or whatever. So this is the Android one for me.
That's exactly it. It's people who look at the flagship ones. Yeah. They can't get it. And the guy in the shop says, oh, well, you get almost all the same features in this thing and it's half the price. And
yeah. So I'm not surprised about the A51 at all, but it's the kind of phone that the person buying it will have not heard of 5 minutes before they buy it. I don't think they're doing themselves any favors with the light branding, because it just doesn't sound that good, does it?
You reviewed the S10 Lite, didn't you?
Yeah, and that's, I mean, it's a brilliant phone, but why call it the S10 Lite this year when we already know, you know, and it looks like the S20? Just so I think if they called that the S20 Lite, it would do a lot better. But
yep.
Anyway, that, you know, a company as big as Samsung's always going to have these sort of mishmash, confusing ranges, I think, because they sort of have the scattergun approach of we'll just make tons and tons of phones and see which ones sell.
And that's before you even take into account like the A20e and the A21s and it's a nightmare.
And some of those have done well as well.
Yeah, there's also J series and is there still K series? I can't remember.
Some markets have a W series. Yeah, we don't get W series. Never did. J series you don't get anymore. Like, yeah, it's fascinating. I think for the UK market specifically, I presume the S20 ranges are doing a lot better overall, because I think especially down south, like premium market is the UK's always been a premium market.
I'm not an expert on Xiaomi, but I think it's possibly interesting that the Xiaomi phones in there are both Redmi devices not like, say, the Mi 9, you know, is one of those phones where we've sung its praises and previous models on that line, but it's actually the Redmi Note stuff that's really popular.
Well, I think it is just telling to their place in the global market that it's Redmi that really kills it for them. Yeah, when we look at the UK and we think about which Xiaomi phones come here that we get excited about, it's the flagship Mi stuff, because for the UK, they're very good value flagships, and that makes sense, and they are affordable for the UK market with top specs. But actually, again, I would guess that's basically a combination of China and India driving absolutely huge Redmi sales, because, you know, Redmi is that step cheaper again, and that at least is where Xiaomi like does the business. I'm sure they'll be looking and wanting to see their more flagship stuff creeping higher up those figures and positioning it in that way, because I'm sure they love the money that's coming in from selling these. I'm sure they don't want it to be their budget range outselling their premium tier, right, as much as if they can shift it around in the other direction.
It's been this way for, I don't know, at least 2 or 3 years, probably longer at this point, but I'd say especially now, and especially with the effects that the pandemic has had on the smartphone sales and on the market, the mid-range market is where the real fighting is. Like, you kind of are sort of somewhat unfettered at the top end, because, you know, once you're approaching 1,000, people just kind of go, okay, it's an expensive phone. Like, however expensive it is, it's an expensive phone. Whereas it's trying to get that price performance balance in the mid range is really, I think, the fiercest part of the market right now. And that's totally, I think, what's going to make, you know, make or break the charts, you know, the chart of biggest sales by the end of the year is in the mid range. That's where people are going to make their money.
Yep. I mean, that feels like as good an excuse as any to move on.
Hey.
Because our next topic of discussion is what looks to me like a pretty competitive mid-range phone. There you can see it just in enormous 2001 monolith size floating across the camera. So the Realme X3 SuperZoom. Toddy, you know way more than either of us about this phone, so I think I better just hand it over to you, really.
Yeah, I've talked about Realme a few times before. I think I'm slightly becoming the resident Realme guy in the office, at least for some of their beefier and more exciting devices. So they launched their first 5G flagship within the last couple of months, I think it was, the X50 Pro. This is interesting for a number of reasons. The X2 Pro launched just at the very end of last year, so not that long ago, but this is effectively the X3 Pro, but there is no X3 Pro. This is the X3 SuperZoom. And the name kind of obviously points to its principal features. It does two things pretty well. I'd say very well for the price. This is a sub £500 phone in the UK, or even €500 in Europe, device. It was also one of the first Realme phones to get a launch in the UK before China. We don't even know if it's coming to China, which I think is another interesting element, because it kind of shows Realme's intentions to really push out as a global brand, or at least a European brand, more so than maybe, you know, its parent or its affiliated company Oppo has, because Oppo made a name for itself in China first and foremost, and has only recently moved out, whereas Realme is kind of going straight for a global audience. And I think this phone kind of shows that. The way this phone has been released shows that. As for the phone itself, it's got a nice big screen. It's got a 120Hz refresh rate, so it's kind of, you know, S20-esque in that regard, or OnePlus 8-esque, depending on which phone is your preferred. And then the camera is, it's a quad camera. Realme loves throwing a bunch of sensors, but the main talking points are 64 meg main sensor, which is pretty good. Nothing too crazy. Low light's a bit weak, but generally speaking, it's a really solid sensor. But the real talking points are it has a periscopic 5x optical zoom. Sensor, just like the Huawei P30 and P40 Pro and the Oppo Find X2 Pro, I believe, and the Oppo Reno 10X Zoom. They're pretty much all of them. Oh, and the S20, I guess, Ultra. And also, it has astrophotography, like the Pixel 4 series. So, as far as I'm aware, it's the only other phone, at least that we've tested, that offers such a mode. I don't know if you guys know of any others.
I don't remember anyone else hyping up an astrophotography.
No, mode. Like just good low light modes, but not like a... Yeah.
Not dedicated, and obviously, yeah.
In those two regards, in the zooming and the astrophotography, it does a really, really good job. Again, for the money, it's I'd say it's excellent value for money. The caveat, which is what my kind of the crux of my review is, especially in the camera section, is that it does what it says it's going to do well, but those features are pretty niche, especially the astrophotography, and that's something we found with the Pixels, Dom, right? Like yeah. You reviewed the 4, I took the 4 XL.
I did find it funny when you said that was sort of the two big things the camera does is the zoom and the astrophotography. And I'm like, wow, you're going to bet half your strategy on astrophotography?
Yeah. I mean, for marketing, I think it's great, because people go look at that. And if they don't think about it too much, that is an impressive thing, and go, oh, yeah, that looks really cool. But then most people, I'm pretty sure, will be taking fewer than one astrophotography image a month, maybe even less. So, to buy a phone for that reason is probably the worst possible reason you could choose to buy this phone.
It does make sense in basically picking out, I think, two of the most hyped flagship features right now are high refresh rate, especially hitting 120, and then big zoom lenses, which obviously we're seeing all the big players basically try and fit in. OnePlus are probably the only exception that didn't go any further than 3x optical. But I guess they're not the only one, there are a few, but more and more that's being a big thing people are trying to make their name on is that zoom. So it definitely seems smart to just go like, what are the two things that most flagships are leaning heavily on, refresh rate and zoom, and say, cool, both of them below 500.
Yeah. And I think the option of it uses a Snapdragon 855 Plus rather than the 865. And I think that's a smart move to help, probably was what allowed them to stay under that £500/€ threshold. I think it wouldn't have been an easy phone to recommend if it was over that, really. I think because it slots into our mid-range bracket by doing that, and I think that is a really important place to be, like I was saying before.
Interesting choice. Sorry,
to go
with the 855 Plus, so last year's flagship, rather than the 765 or the 765G, which are, you know, Qualcomm's new second tier processors for this year. Which I suspect end up delivering similar-ish performance. I don't know if they're more expensive component-wise because of the 5G element. I know that's been a big issue with the 865, is the 5G modem driving up prices. So I wonder if the 855 Plus... I know it's probably still a bit faster than the 765, but Yeah, I wonder what the thinking was there. Is it a cost efficiency, or is it going for performance over 5G? Or
yeah, I mean, they're both like 7-nanometer chips. They're both very efficient chips. The 855 that launched, like that started appearing in phones at the first half of 2019, is still a very good chip. And the 855 Plus is really just an overclocked version of that, if you're not aware. So yeah, I have no doubts, and I say this again in the review, that this phone will last you probably for like 2 years if you look after it quite happily. I think it's got what you could still consider flagship class performance. In benchmarking, it's not quite as high as the 865, but no one, you know, as we always know with these new chips, when a new chip launches, we don't see the benefits of that really until a year down the line, where it's still being able to hold its own, whereas, you know, a lesser chip, a mid-range chip, can't last that long. It can't operate at the same level for that long. So yeah, I think they were really smart to pair all the hardware that they have in here. Loads of RAM, UFS3 storage like an S20 or like, you know, OnePlus. The main thing is that price point, 469 in the UK. You really do need to consider whether this is worth getting for the camera, because if it's not for the camera, I'd probably swing to the OnePlus 7T, because that's now dropped down to the exact same price. And right. I personally prefer the fit and finish. You know, there's a plastic frame on here. You get metal on the OnePlus. There's an Oxygen OS. I think that user experience is still better than what the Realme and Oppo phones are working with. Color OS has come a long way. Realme UI, as it's called here, which is basically the same thing, have come a long way. But yeah, I think the OnePlus 7T still clinches it, even though it doesn't have these fancy camera features, because they are too niche for most people to, you know, choose a phone for.
This does have the refresh rate, though. Though, again, I think that's kind of a thing a lot of people won't really notice.
But 90 hertz is already better. Like 90 to 120, it's not a huge... So it's a good phone, no doubt, but it's a tricky recommendation, mainly because the 7T exists. So it really does come down to whether you think that... that camera is worth it.
It's interesting that you compare to OnePlus, because Realme seem to be the new OnePlus. You know,
in a way,
so
they are.
In
yeah,
so many ways, they're you know, they're even using the flagship killer motto that I think I mentioned when we were talking about one of their other phones. But yeah, they seem to be doing a pretty good job of saying, right, here's some sort of high end features that now we're going to give to you on this really cheap phone. I'm also trying to work out who they're pitching it at, because it's all quite techie, it's all quite nerdy. Like, they're making a big deal of this is the only phone with like the Zoom and the Snapdragon 855 Plus in the world, even though that's an old processor. And so, are they expecting their potential buyers to know these details? Like,
as a brand, they've made huge strides in India, and I think that market, this phone probably won't have a problem selling. The problem, you know, India is a huge market, and to have that under your belt and have that in your corner is great, obviously. But yeah, in terms of the global stage, India is a pretty specific market as well. And I don't think as you're saying, like in the launch, which was just yesterday as we record this, the techie angle was a huge part of how they pitched this phone. And I don't think most average European or UK consumers really care that much. Like, as long as it takes a good picture and it lasts them and they think it's value for money, then yeah, fine. Yeah, it's not 5G, it's not Wi-Fi 6 enabled or anything like that. It has got fast charging, which is nice. But yeah, you're right to kind of question who it's for, because that is a tough recommendation. I think the OnePlus, again, has more mass appeal. I think people will appreciate the overall experience that offers, because it feels that little bit tighter, a little bit more developed. Whereas I think the tech heads would be more swayed perhaps by this, because it has those big numbers to throw around.
But then I think that's partly a question to where they are in their sort of life cycle in the market, in that if you look back, that's what OnePlus did. When they started out, OnePlus was techie and nerdy, and the point was get passionate early adopters on board, build a fan base, build people who will be champions for your brand and will go out and tell their friends about this phone that they've never heard of and say, this is the phone you should buy. You've never heard of it, but let me promise you, it's better than anything else you can get for the same price. And they go and be like evangelists for the brand. And I think that's what Realme's trying to get. Yeah, they're not messaging to the general market. They're messaging to the people who might become Realme fans, who will then go on and message to the bigger market for them. And then in a year from now, in 2 years from now, they can broaden out their own messaging once they have that foothold, I guess. I assume that's what they're thinking.
Yeah, it sounds like a reasonable plan, doesn't it, to basically follow in the footsteps of OnePlus, especially now they've sort of left that, like, here's your affordable but flagship-esque device. But I suppose the question is it too late to do that, because OnePlus have already sort of gathered up all of those people, and OnePlus users are, you know, supposedly some of the most loyal around, because OnePlus is so good at, you know, communicating and listening to them and stuff. So are there any of those people left, or are there enough OnePlus users that are missing those affordable flagships, or have OnePlus managed to drag them up to the more expensive phones? I don't know.
Well, it's also worth remembering, I don't want to dwell on it too long, but, you know, just this week, Pete Lau also confirmed that they are working, OnePlus is back working on cheaper phones, and they want to expand their portfolio, go away from the one or two devices at a time. They think they're big enough to do that, which is basically a kind of, like, you know, does feel like a bit of a warning shot at all the brands who are looking to fill in the space OnePlus has vacated in the market. And OnePlus is saying, like, no, we're coming back for that. Like,
yeah,
we're getting flagships now, but that £500 space we just left, like, that's still ours. We're coming back, probably the OnePlus Z or Z later this year. We hope that that hasn't been confirmed, but, you know, there will be cheaper OnePlus phones again. They're just now going to start doing that together with flagships. So anyone trying to move into that space like Realme is, it could look like it's less competitive right now than it is if OnePlus are going to come back and could win back that fan base they kind of left behind a bit with the last two releases.
And it'll be interesting to see what the Pixel 4a turns out to be like, whether that can be the new mid-range king, and even what Motorola can do. If we set aside the confusing the G8 line, of which there's another one now. There's a Moto G8 Pro. So let's just forget about all the Moto G8s.
4a is definitely a bit different, though, because I feel like the Pixels will just sit in a space where it may be rated as the best mid-range, but it won't sell anything like any of its rivals anyway. So it's
kind of the 4a will be a great mid-ranger for the US market, and then everywhere else it'll be all right, but then there'll be a better Chinese phone to choose. Like, that's just how that'll work. But the Realme, like, we're talking about them as being kind of like old OnePlus with their tech, you know, tech first as their angle, and building up this kind of family of avid fans. But they're also playing a second game, which is kind of like old Samsung or current Samsung, depending on how you look at it. They are also just flooding the market with phones, and they've kind of done that from the off. Like, they only, I think I mentioned previously, they only started in 2017 as a company. I think they released their first phone in 2018. When I looked, although this phone technically launched with at least one or two other handsets, this is about their 12th phone this year alone. I don't think, maybe Motorola, but I don't think anyone else has got that. Maybe Samsung. They're like the only two I can think of that might have that many phones that are 2020 devices already. They are prolific. And I think that'll pay off in, you know, on the store shelves, someone looking for a cheap phone in car phone warehouse, if they saw like a Realme 6S or something.
But that's the issue there, is that will work. Again, I feel like the mistake they're making right now is applying their Indian strategy to Europe.
Mm-hmm.
To some extent, because that may work in India, because I'm guessing in India, where they've been big for a while, they have the distribution network. They've only just arrived in Europe, which means they are not in car phone warehouse. They're not in the high street shops. Not that we can go to them anyway, but, you know, they're they don't have that physical retail presence. So they have a load of handsets sitting on Amazon or the Realme official website.
That
doesn't matter if people aren't seeing them in shop. Flooding the market with handsets makes sense when you've got physical retail presence, because there can be a whole shelf of nothing but your brand, because you put enough handsets out that you can occupy that space. But if you're not occupying physical shops, then it's a moot point. Hopefully, I'm sure they are doing everything in their power to get that distribution, to get on with the big networks and carriers, and I'm sure they will, but they're not there yet. So actually releasing 10 phones in a quarter, it won't necessarily help them yet in Europe.
Yeah, unless, like, that's exactly how OnePlus, you know, got exposed to the full UK market. It was by getting, I think they started off with O2 and then went from there, and, you know, into car phone warehouse and stuff. So
it took time.
Yep. I'm sure Realme will sell some devices to the people who are following them and know who they are now. But yeah, to your average Joe on the high street, they need to they need to do the same thing and get into Carphone Warehouse and that, which, you know, don't know if there's space or not.
Yeah,
maybe not right now.
Well, there might be space vacating because things are getting worse and worse and worse for Huawei. So still being stopped segue. By the big brands, but for how much longer? Yeah, so I think we've got a few bits of Huawei sort of stuff to cover. I mean, rounding off the top, we didn't talk about this at the time, but a couple of weeks ago, the US extended its trade ban officially by another year till March 2021. Or is it May 2021? Anyway, spring next year. So there is definitely another 12 months or so of not having Google services on Huawei phones, Huawei products not being sold in the US, and all the other complications that brings them. The second blow they suffered, at least specific to the UK, is that under sort of the pressure around the coronavirus situation, which has rightly or wrongly impacted relations with China internationally, the UK government is under renewed pressure to strip Huawei out of its 5G infrastructure, which it had previously said it wouldn't do, and now it looks like it is backtracking and will. And I think it's basically said it's the current proposal is to get everything Huawei out of the system by 2023. And then finally, something that sort of broke a week or so ago, and then it sort of sat quietly, and people didn't really, I think, pick up on the full impact of this. But the US trade ban essentially got subtly tweaked and expanded, which meant that companies that want to use US IP to create products to sell to Huawei now need to get permission. That sounds a bit convoluted, but the important thing to take away from it is that the Taiwanese silicon manufacturer that Huawei used to use, so Taiwanese company, not American, but they used ARM sort of designs and things like that to build their silicon. Because of that, they are no longer allowed to sell to Huawei. That means, unless they can find a workaround, no more Kirin processors. Because the current system was Huawei designed its own Kirin processors in-house and then got this company to build them for it, using some ARM stuff as well. It's not sort of pure Huawei design. And basically, that's the bit that they can't do anymore. So unless they can go back to the drawing board and build this stuff from scratch with no American IP whatsoever, which is not likely, this is probably the end of the Kirin processor line as we know it. And already, Honor and Huawei are beginning to talk about moving towards using MediaTek processors mm-hmm. instead, which they already use in some of their very low-end devices. They sort of use some of the budget MediaTek chips, but they might now start having to use MediaTek all the way up. And it could be that by the sort of this time next year, we are seeing P-series phones with a MediaTek chip in them, which would be bad news for Huawei because MediaTek does not have the global clout that Snapdragon does or even that Kirin does as its own brand. And it's going to cost it more to buy processors than design its own. But really good news for MediaTek, which is trying to step up its game and be more of a Snapdragon rival. And this could be a huge thing for it if it goes well.
I mean, they're an interesting company. They've always kind of been, not the black sheep, but they've always been sort of second-class citizens in the processor race. And partly because manufacturers only ever did put their chips in their mid or low range phones. Mm-hmm. And benchmarking, you know, reflected that. Like, they just didn't compete with what Qualcomm was putting out there. But they were more affordable for the manufacturers. And that's been their biggest, I think, asset. With you saying that they're already trying to change things on their own, like, they already have a couple of 5G chips under their Dimensity branding.
Yeah.
Which I think is a good move to have some chips already available to manufacturers to use. I think this could break one of two ways for MediaTek in terms of if Huawei goes all in on them or mostly in on them and starts investing in them more to get more power out of the chips and to get more efficient chips, we might start to see some much more competitive silicon out of MediaTek, which, you know, that could be interesting in its own right and might be able to keep Huawei afloat in the kind of consumer competition with their phones. Alternatively, the MediaTek sort of that perception of MediaTek might rub off on Huawei even more so than it itself is already enduring and just actually dragging them down further. So I'm curious to see over the course of this next, what, year or so, if that change does go into full effect, how that affects both the brand perception of MediaTek and Huawei.
Totally. I mean, and if MediaTek aren't ready to have something flagship level that could compete with the Snapdragon 875 or whatever next year, you know, if there's a Huawei flagship coming out that benchmarks badly, that just looks bad for both companies. It looks like Huawei can't compete in the flagship space anymore because they can't put in flagship chips, and it looks bad to MediaTek because it looks like push came to shove and they couldn't deliver. On the other hand, like you said, if they can put an affordable, they can put something in there that does the numbers for a Huawei flagship, you could certainly imagine other Asian manufacturers beginning to look at that as a way to sort of subvert Qualcomm's dominance in the sector. And we've heard so many complaints about Snapdragon 865 pricing being an issue for manufacturers this year.
Huge.
So if MediaTek can, you know, it's a good thing for the industry if MediaTek can step up and we can have a proper rivalry in the flagship silicon space that we just haven't had in the phone market for years. And you could certainly see a lot of other companies jumping ship, or at least considering more with each phone which way they go with it. And it would force Qualcomm to be more competitive in its pricing, even though it's already competitive in its specs, obviously.
Yeah, it's mirroring, you know, it's a very similar sort of situation to Intel AMD over the many, many years of them producing, you know, desktop and laptop silicon. It's like, you know, one's dominant and has the brand power and the other one's the underdog. And yeah, I think like Toddy says, this could go either way. It could bring MediaTek up to that same level and give them the same, a similar sort of brand power that Qualcomm's had for a long time now, or it could just not work out for either company. But then I think Huawei's, you know, the Google services issue is still bigger for Huawei,
for sure,
because, you know, that's the thing that's going to affect consumers more. Sorry, the dog's saying hello. guest appearance, finally.
Guest appearance, Scout.
But like you say, you know, MediaTek's always been the processor in phones where people don't need to know what the processor is.
Yeah.
So, putting them in the P, whatever the 50, the other flagship Huawei's, isn't going to look as good, but if they can get the performance that they need out of it, yeah, it could give them the boost they need.
I guess the question is whether MediaTek are at all ready to make chips at that. I don't even know if they have chips at that level, because obviously their 5G stuff, the Dimensity that Alex mentioned earlier, again, they made a point there of going mid-range with that, which was a good thing, because it drove their sort of, if you want to make a 5G phone that's a bit more affordable, the MediaTek becomes really appealing because they put 5G into cheaper chipsets than Qualcomm has. And that's great. But again, I just don't know if they make any silicon that can match an 865. And then I can't imagine that's the kind of industry where you can pivot quickly enough to produce that in time for 2021 flagships, just because you get Huawei on board. And if Huawei is going to be a big thing, they, you know, that, the Huawei is, you know, top few phone manufacturers worldwide, and they'll want to be able to satisfy that demand. That would be a huge client for them. But how quickly can they pivot and start doing that? And I wonder whether Huawei will be trying to lend their Kirin design expertise to them even to help speed that along any. I don't know how closely they'll be willing to work together.
Another thing I'm wondering is, obviously right now, like, kind of the US government's eye of Sauron has turned on Huawei specifically. But, like, there's a chance that if it just feels strongly about any of the other mobile manufacturers, particularly the other Chinese ones like Xiaomi or Oppo or one, you know, even OnePlus, which has a presence in the US, if they suddenly decide, you know, oh, they're Chinese and therefore they might also be spying on us, or whatever reason that they decide to come up with, I'm wondering whether other manufacturers are already looking at other ways of producing their phones that also don't rely as heavily on US either patents or infrastructure in any way. And that might also be a driving force behind, you know, better competition against companies like Qualcomm from manufacturers in Taiwan, manufacturers in China. So that could be really interesting.
it's impossible to imagine that Xiaomi and Oppo don't have proper backup plans ready for this. Because yeah. Huawei,
like, a team working away quickly to try and figure out.
Huawei was obviously caught on the back foot a little bit, and they'd obviously talked about having plans ready, but it clearly still took them by surprise when it actually happened, and whatever plans they had were not sufficient, and they weren't really ready for this.
App Gallery was the perfect demonstration of how they weren't ready for this.
But you can be absolutely sure that the others are all looking at this. I mean, we're seeing it a bit in sort of all this the File Transfer Alliance, that little body of Chinese manufacturers coming together to try and put together a proper Android file transfer system, that because Google just never did. And
that's
that's
Xiaomi, Vivo, OnePlus, Meizu, Oppo. Is Oppo in there?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it's certainly because it started out as two or three, and another few joined last week. So it's like five or six manufacturers now. That definitely looks like the public facing edge of bigger backroom discussions about right, how do Chinese tech companies manage with this? And surely there's a backup plan, that whether they're working together or whether they just each individually got backup plans. But again, if MediaTek can be a silicon provider that sits outside of the trade ban, and the US can't find another way to extend the ban's intricacies to catch MediaTek as well somehow. Other than that, yeah, you've got to think a lot of them will be looking at whether and when they can pivot to using MediaTek for more stuff if there's a risk they're suddenly not going to be able to use Qualcomm anymore.
I think you make a good point about how quickly can they pivot and turn around and change all their plans. Like, you know, these phone makers will have a roadmap, you know, many years into the future where they're planning all the devices. And changing something like this is not easy from what I know about silicon. And you don't just suddenly make a new, you know, a better processor in like a few weeks. It just doesn't work like that.
Weekly, I suppose it probably is worth saying, as we're saying about other company, the phone manufacturers having presumably been having backup plans for the last year while this Huawei stuff went down. If MediaTek has any sense, they spent the last year trying to figure out how to take Qualcomm's place in that market and seeing this as an opportunity. And again, you would expect that behind the scenes, they have been working to get to this level of doing the flagship chips, because they must see that there is a very easy argument for them to just go to Xiaomi, to Oppo, and say, why wait for the US to say you're not allowed to work with Qualcomm? Why not get ahead of it? Stop being so reliant on US manufacturers before you need to do it, like, without a choice. And, you know, we've obviously seen them pushing their brand a little bit further over the last year, the way they've handled the 5G stuff, the way they're beginning to reach out to the press more than they used to. They're definitely trying to be more of a competitor to Qualcomm. And I suspect this is something MediaTek have been readying themselves for. Whether they expected Huawei to be the first customer or not, I don't know, given that I don't think anyone figured Kirin was going anywhere too soon. But we'll see. It's a big change, and this could be amazing news for MediaTek, and it could be very good news for the market in general. But there is no way to see this as anything other than bad news for Huawei, which is now crippled on software and hardware. Yeah. And it's just hard to see... It's getting harder and harder for that consumer side of them to keep going and working outside of the Chinese market. They're still doing fine in the Chinese market, but this is just yet another blow to their prospects of selling phones in Europe, because if it doesn't even, it's going to start tanking their reviews, both hardware-wise and software-wise, which is rough for them.
And let's not forget the 5G stuff. If the UK's, you know, pulling out, you know, all their stuff, that's got to be a huge financial loss. And also just doesn't look good for them as a brand. Like, you know, consumer trust with a brand is
totally,
you know, something that's never going to not be important.
Yeah.
Hugely important for people to trust a brand that they're buying. And when they, you know, on top of all these bans and all these issues and Google, you know, services, if the UK is officially saying, oh, we're not going to use their stuff, that doesn't look good for the average Joe who doesn't understand tech. They're like, oh, well, I better not buy their phone then.
Yeah, totally. Absolutely.
It's a different effect. Yeah, it's a different bit of the company, but I think it's always been my opinion that actually the effect on sales is probably greater from the 5G stuff than it is from the Google thing. I think the average consumer doesn't know Huawei phones don't have Google until they get in the shop and get told, but the average UK consumer knows Huawei's involved in 5G, and is it good that they're involved in 5G? And people are a bit unsure about whether they should be and whether they're like spying for China on us and all of that. And so I think that has a bigger effect on public image.
And a lot of Huawei's you know, finance comes from their communications side of it, which again, most people wouldn't know, but like, you know, most, you know, routers from the big broadband companies and stuff is all Huawei stuff inside. So, you know, to lose a lot of these contracts will cost them millions, if not billions.
Absolutely. Right. Well, that's a nice cheery note to end on for the week. Thanks, Chris.
Sorry.
For lifting up all our spirits in this troubling time.
Well, it's sunny.
The dog appeared, that was nice.
We did get Scout making her proper on-camera debut. Thank you to everyone who has stuck with us through this week's episode. Jump in the comments if you have any questions at all. Like and subscribe, all of that, and we will be back here same time, same place next week.